Mini chapter 30. Evelyn's soundtrack comes alive. Now that Jaymi is approaching the release of his second beast, Evelyn, he can look back and register that his earlier release of Amber had a certain simplicity to it, because while it was happening, there was no previous such act he could compare it with. The process of his creating Amber out of nothing and then allowing him to slither out of the monitor was a kind of convulsion. He was hardly in control of it while it occurred, but was rather a conduit. Whence Amber was incarnated, fully formed, endowed with a volition of primal power and a beauty that was monstrous. This more deliberate creation cycle for the building of Evelyn has so far been a less convulsive affair. Still, he's been unable to remain fully in control of it. Yesterday, she started talking at him unbidden, for instance, and about the linnet of all things. Then she whisked him from the linnet fields of Dorset, through a Siberian forest with bellowing stags in the distance, then up over the Arctic Ocean, before abandoning him in a freezing blizzard to find his own way back down to Earth and the Melrose Avenue building. That was a bit rich, to be frank, but her own choice of track now rises again by itself, all around him. The smile in her voice floats down at him, slow and wide and mellow as a grin upon her sunny face, and yet it's sad and haunting, indicating avenues unfolding into future joy, although the view back home will show a place that has died. She beckons him aside, confiding in a whisper. "Thanks for my soundtrack, Jaymi." Then she cocks her ear as if to catch the last of a vanishing echo, murmuring, "Ah, yes, continuous relaxing favourites, not to mention soft classics. Timeless timepieces and timely information. A winning combination, coasting into a smooth finish. Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm." A thrill runs through Jaymi. His new beast's audio is coming alive. But where is she getting these vocal stylings from, ominously strange as they are? It's as if she has flitted around at ease through her creator while he wasn't looking, snatching up evocative samples echoing down audio passageways that he'd forgotten about. "I'd just like to jet in for a moment," she continues, "regarding the ocean where I left you last time. Well, in the deeps of that ocean, there's an inky black pool of water that's saltier than the miles of water above, and around this still pool is a coastline, as it were, lined by crabs and worms. If you mash them up, do you know that a group of hydras or sponges will gradually reassemble into complete animals?" Jaymi hears the whisper of a sudden silverfish upon the tiles of her bathroom in the Metropolitan Hotel on Asbury Avenue, where he'll be housing her and the imagination thief. And she scoops the silverfish up into a roll of paper and runs down to the Asbury Park boardwalk and lets it go, with a kiss to the paper, as this little creature of an ancient order slides away, coiling into the moonlight. Sand hornets cut the air. Glistening on the shore ahead, crustaceans of mud scuttle down over lugworms into lapping wavelets. Further back and down, where the continental shelf ends, a rush and flap of species more exotic. Black goldfish, peroxide blonde fish, then express fish and sea serpents. Then, listening back to when the mountains were seabeds, the mountain fish, now in fossil form upon the rock. She reclines by the petrified mountain fish. Jaymi goes to join her and they sit, like bees on a rock face, waiting for the sun, ricochet of rabbits in the mountains, scampering. Pebbles scatter, feathers ripping up through a yellow-grey sky, then a shortwave piping of peewits and curlews. White horses flow through her soundtrack now, where the art of the mouse is hidden too, for the mountain is bestial. Sylphs and gnomes and manticores bound up its slopes under Evelyn's direction. At her whim, a stately sheep, a blonde sheep, peevish to be sure, but ceremonial, processional, passes by in front of her and Jaymi, then recedes to the left. Out above the mountain range ahead, a vision dances, with shafts of light, cloudscapes, horses' heads and circles in the sky. Then Jaymi feels Evelyn clap her hands with easy grace and lands back down in the Melrose Avenue building, with her soundtrack completed and the feeling of a violin flower open wide in him.